Hi, good evening, everyone. I extend you all a very warm welcome to this fifth webinar series, which is an educational initiative jointly undertaken by Philip Capital and BSC with the sole objective of sharing knowledge and market insights for everyone connected to global markets. My name is Vishakha and I'm the part of FX Advisory Desk at Philip Capital. So Philip Capital is a Singapore-based company established in 1975, having global presence in 15 countries. We have over 1 million clients worldwide with assets under management of more than $13 million. Now, at this onset, I would like to thank Mr. Ojish Shah and Mr. Anant Narayan for sparing their valuable time and for consenting to be a part of this webinar series to share their valuable market insights. I would like to invite Mr. Ojish Shah, who is the Head Business Development West Region at BSC, to share his part of his speech. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, hi Vishakha. My voice is audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of BSC, I welcome you all to this webinar. Special thanks to Philip Capital for organizing this webinar and providing us the platform to talk about the products and services being offered by Exchange to all the market participants. I would like to also thank Mr. Anant Narayan for making convenient for this event. As you all know, entire globe is gradually moving towards the technology-driven landscape. When it comes to financial asset classes, BSC has always been at the forefront in terms of the technological offerings. BSC is the fastest exchange in the world with response time of less than 6 microseconds. When it comes to product innovation, BSC has always strived to offer innovative product offerings to market participants. BSC has been the first exchange in India to launch weekly contracts on currency derivatives, weekly contracts in equity derivatives with innovative concept of Friday expiry, negative pricing mechanism in Brent crude commodity contract, options on goods on gold, gold mini, silver and silver kg contracts. It is the first world's first exchange to launch the element contract in the commodities derivative space. It is also the first exchange to launch the India International Exchange at GIFT City, and which has the lion's market share from day one of the launch. BSC has always strived to provide all our associates with new product offerings like mutual funds, insurance, in addition to the equity derivatives and currency derivatives platform. This has proved to be a major business for most of the entities as the dynamics of the broking industry has changed to the practically third-party product distribution products. BSC is also offering the Star MF mutual fund, which has practically most of the AMCs with 99% of the schemes covered in it, and it is a digital platform. BSC has also started offering the insurance along with joint venture with BSC EBIX Insurance Broking, which offers life and non-life under single platform to all the individual partners. Let me quickly run through the benefits of trading and investing through BSC. So we come to equity cash segment. As you all know, BSC has the largest number of listed companies, and it is lower in terms of the transaction charges. It is also a preferred exchange for IPO, FPO, OFS, OTB, GSEC, T-bills, sovereign gold bonds, etc. When it comes to equity derivative segment, BSC has tried to bring innovative concept to the market from the legacy concept of Thursday expiry, where BSC has launched the weekly contracts with Friday expiry concept. It has zero transaction charges in equity derivative segment, so participants can avail the benefit of zero transaction charges. I will come to commodities derivative segment. It is the second largest exchange in terms of daily turnover. It is the first exchange to offer options on goods. We would like to take pride in telling that there has been consistent physical delivery happening in the commodities derivative space, in the options on goods contract, as well as the agri contracts like almond and turmeric, where consistent physical deliveries are happening. We come to this today's agenda or concept of related to the FX market. In currency derivatives, BSC is the largest Forex trading platform in India. It offers trading and hedging opportunities in USD, GBP, Euro, JPY, and along with that, it also offers cross-currency pairs. It is the lowest in transaction charges. It is offering practically in futures, we are offering at 20 rupees per crore as the transaction charges, while in options, we are offering at 100 rupees per crore on the premium turnover, which is practically the lowest in the currency derivative space. Another important point I would like to talk over here, it is India International Exchange, which is located at GIFT City, which is International Exchange, where you can trade for 22 hours a day, basically. So it is available for 22 hours market access. And it has products like indices, equities, currencies, interest rate derivatives, all products under a single roof. So you can access all the products under India International Exchange that is available 22 hours a day. Important point to talk about here is the access to the currency derivatives market is also available for 22 hours a day. It is the world's fastest exchange. One important point I would like to draw attention of the market participant is the recent technological glitch at one of the leading exchange, where the exchange was shut completely for hours basically, and members were unable to trade or even square up or even hedge their positions in the equity derivatives, equity cash, and even the FX market as well. So I'd like to inform the market participants that with interoperability amongst the clearing corporations, now any client can trade on any exchange at any point of time and square up their positions. That includes currency derivatives as well. So all the members, since it was a expiry day of currency derivatives contract on 24th of February when the tech glitch had happened, the clients who had access to BSE currency derivatives as well could seamlessly trade or roll over their positions in all the BSE segments, including currency derivatives segment. And hence, I would like to inform all the market participants to approach your stockbroker and get access to BSE currency derivatives, do the needful paperwork related to the KYC and access to BSE platforms, including FX. So that will help you in terms of getting the benefit of lower transaction charge as well, highly liquid exchange as well, and also probably an additional facility if at all there is any technological glitch at any of the exchanges. You can trade at any of the other exchange and you can hedge or trade your positions. With this, I would like to conclude my talk over here. I'd like to thank all the participants for making it convenient to attend this webinar on this Saturday evening. I'd request Vishakha to take it over from here.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Anant Narayan. So he is one of the prominent market veterans and an eminent speaker on various panels and forums pertaining to global financial markets. Mr. Narayan has more than 24 years of experience in banking and financial markets with organizations such as Standard, Deutsche and Citibank. Mr. Narayan is on the board of various advisory committee of regulatory authorities like RBI and SEBI. And currently he dons a professor hat in the role of associate professor at SPJ Institute of Management and Research. No amount of introduction would summarize your experience and achievements, sir, but yet I have made an attempt to do so. So with that note, I would like to welcome you once again. I would request all the participants to write their questions in the chat box of Philip Capital India during the sessions, if any. We would take them up at the end of the session. Thank you so much. Over to you, sir.
Thanks a lot and really appreciate. Thank you, Philip Capital. And thank you, Ojas. That was good to hear about the BSE. Thanks for that chat. Special thanks to Philip Capital to have allowed me to change the date at last minute. Truly apologize for the inconvenience and really appreciate the fact that you could do that. Much appreciated. So you've given me a lovely topic, yeah, dynamics of inflation and interest rates on FX markets. If I was to wear my professor hat right now, I could speak for the next couple of hours, but I'll try and limit myself for 25 to 30 minutes on this. So why don't I do this? I'll try and break it up into two or three parts. Let's call it three parts. First is, let's look at what's happening on inflation. Okay, is there an inflation risk in India, in the world? And related to that, why is there an inflation risk in India at all? I mean, why does India suffer from inflation the way it does? Second question would be, what does inflation mean for monetary policy and for liquidity? Okay. Now, I want to ask some existential questions here. We have some answers in our head, you know, monetary policy has to do this when inflation goes up. But I want to dig a little deeper. What can monetary policy do to control the kind of inflation we are seeing in India right now? So that's the second chunk of question. And the third question would be, so what does that mean for FX market specifically? So what does it do for dollar rupee? What does it do for forwards and so on and so forth? And what's happening in the market currently, the way I see it as a professor right now. So let's start with the first problem. Does India have an inflation problem? Let's put it this way. The conditions that we see right now in India in the past, when these conditions have come together, we have seen inflation in India. What are these conditions? Here are a few of them. First, the terms of trade shifting towards the rural sector. In India, by the way, 65% of India stays in the rural sector, in the rural countryside, which accounts for 45% of our GDP. Now, if you look at the numbers, clearly the rural sector has done well through COVID-19 compared to their urban counterparts. For one, agriculture has done well. Second, the government has spent a lot of money, including on employment guarantee schemes, on farmer schemes, etc. Third, COVID-19 did not impact the rural sector as much. Now, when the money shifts towards the rural sector, typically in the past, we have seen both protein inflation as well as overall headline inflation. So that's point number one. Second, a very obvious one that we can all see, commodity prices are going up, including energy prices, including global food prices, and things like copper, steel, a bunch of commodities going up. In fact, if you look at the commodity basket, it's about 16 to 20% higher than it was the same time last year. Specifically, energy has gone up. You know that oil prices have gone up. And of course, including the taxes, it's even higher on the at the retail level. Third, there are supply chain disruptions, not just in India, but globally. Look at chips globally. Look at automobile spare parts globally. There's a long waiting list for even cars, not just in India, by the way, in many countries in the world. So supply chain disruptions are there, and that is causing cost push inflation as well. Fourth, we have an extremely high fiscal deficit, right? In the past, whenever we've seen our country go through high fiscal deficits, the most easy example is 2009, 2013, that has translated into higher inflation risk as well. Fifth, there are several sectors of the economy like power, like telecom, where tariffs will have to be increased. These are not viable sectors today. So once those tariff increases come through, that will push through inflation as well. Sixth, there's also money in the hands of people, which is very difficult to understand this. We've gone through a very tough COVID-19 situation. So how the hell is it that money has come in the hands of people? Well, money has come in the hands of people because there's been government spending and because there's also been a lot of FX inflows which have come into the system. So if you look at what's called money supply, which is cash in the currency in circulation, currency in or other deposits in both current account, savings account, as well as in fixed deposits, all of that has grown quite a bit. So what we call currency in circulation is up by about 22% year on year. If you look at only the current account and savings account, that's up by another 18-19% per year. So overall, what we call M1, which is the currency in circulation plus this savings account, current account, that's up by 20% year on year. And typically when that money lies in the hands of people, you do see consumption going up and you also see asset prices going up. So these factors, and there are many other factors, I don't want to go into them, including what's happening globally. By the way, global inflation is also turning out to be higher than expected. So if you look at Europe, for instance, for the month of January, both Germany specifically and Europe as a whole, EU as a whole, saw inflation much, much higher than what ECB had projected, closer to 1%, 1.3%, whereas ECB had projected something like 0.25%. So even globally, inflation is ticking up and expected to pick up, given that we are coming from a very low base. So all these factors in the past, when they've come together, India's inflation has not done well. Now, the last print was 4.06% for January. So you would ask, where is the inflation? Unfortunately, from here on, inflation looks like it's going to go up. So the next print for February might be 5.25% or so. For March might even be closer to 6%. And then beyond that, core inflation is between 5.75 and 5.90 for about a year. It could stay at that high. It could even be higher than that. Now, broader question, why on earth does India suffer from inflation? By the way, last year also India had inflation, right? If you remember, through COVID-19. The rest of the world was not worried about inflation at all that time, right? In fact, there were people like Bernanke standing up and saying inflation aayi nahi sakta hai, anywhere in the world. Only places like India, Turkey, Argentina had inflation. So the basic question which always comes in our mind is, when there is so much of excess capacity, RBI's data itself shows that capacity utilization is at very low, 60% odd, maybe now it's at 70%. There is so much of excess capacity. There is so much of underemployment. There are so many people who are looking for better jobs. How is it that we have inflation coming through at all? And here I want to go back to what happened in 2009, 2013. If you remember, after the global financial crisis, Pranabda was the finance minister, and he decided that the country has to get a nice fiscal push. So the fiscal deficit was blown up quite a bit. What happened after that? Consumption went up, investments went up. At that point of time, banks were lending as well. You know, 25-30% the credit growth was happening at that point in time. And government spending also went up because of this fiscal spending, right? All three put together should have given us good, robust GDP growth. But all this demand was not matched by domestic production. We did not create enough output to match this demand we were creating. So what was happening as a result? Our net imports was growing by something like 30% year on year. So all the money that we were creating by government spending, by credit growth, etc., was not being met by supply from domestic output. It was being met by imports, or it was chasing items which have limited production, like, you know, proteins, eggs, meat, chicken, and so on and so forth, you know, milk, etc., which have limited production, where inflation was coming up. Either which way, whether you import or whether you end up having limited domestic supply, you have inflation coming through. And of course, in 2009, 2013, along with inflation, you also had a current account crisis, you also had a fiscal deficit crisis, and you also had eventually a taper tantrum in 2013, leading to a lot of issues. So our basic core issue, which frankly is the solution to all our problems, forget about monetary policy, fiscal policy, is just creating enough domestic output. Now, easy for a professor like me to sit on a chair and say, create domestic output, but it's a huge challenge. But if we had created, if we created enough domestic output and jobs, obviously, we will have no problem whatsoever, whether inflation, whether imports, whether current account, nothing, no problem at all, or even fiscal deficit for that matter. So that is the nature of our problem. Whenever we create demand, we start to see inflation. We don't have enough domestic output. And where do we create demand? Either in food and proteins or in things like electronics, gold, you know, plastics, toys, machinery, fertilizers, you know, washing machines, cars, all of which have large imported components, okay? Which is why the import bill goes up quite dramatically. And by the way, look at the import bill for December, November, December, and January. In all three cases, imports have come up quite dramatically. So again, whenever we are seeing consumption going up, we tend to see imports going up, and it shows our inability to create domestic production in adequate quantities. So by the way, all the things I'm mentioning right now about domestic consumption coming up are assuming we don't have a second wave of COVID-19. Okay, that is out of syllabus. Please wear your mask whenever you go outside. If we have COVID-19, it's a biggest disaster. We can't handle it. Okay, so we are seeing a small spike in numbers now. Hopefully it stays as a spike and doesn't really trouble us going forward. So that's the first part. We do have an inflation problem. If things continue the way they are, we could end up with an inflation problem. Now, let's look at from a monetary perspective. So therefore, what should RBI do? And forget about all the dogmas we have heard that monetary policy, change repo rate, wagara, wagara. Ignore all that. Let's start from basic principles. What can RBI do? Primary point I want to make, this is not really a monetary inflation. This is to do with not enough domestic output. Okay, we have to underline that in our head. Now, domestic output is not in RBI's hand. So what should RBI do? Is there a monetary inflation at all, some element of monetary inflation at all in what we are seeing? What is monetary inflation? Monetary inflation is when you have too much of money in the system chasing too few goods, okay? And how did we define money earlier? I talked about money, right? Currency in circulation, current account, savings account, and fixed deposits. Those are the monies which go around in the system. That's called velocity of money. When they go around in the system, they create consumption, they create demand, etc., right? So is there too much money in the system? There is. Okay, there is a lot of money in the system. Can it create demand? It will. To some extent, it will. So a lot of that currency in circulation, by the way, is estimated to be in the rural sector. That will create healthy demand. It's good. It's good that demand comes back. But it will create demand, and therefore the risk of inflation will come in. Now, how does a central bank typically try and control monetary inflation? So the one way it can do that is to try and reduce this volume of money. You try and reduce the amount of currency in circulation, the amount of current account, savings account, the amount of fixed deposit. All put together is, by the way, called M3. Okay, you try and reduce the growth. You can't bring it down, but at least you try and curtail the growth. Okay, so how do you curtail the growth? So the next question is, what creates this money? Now, fundamentally, there are three things which create this money. First is credit growth. When banks give out loans, So if you go to a bank and ask for a housing loan, they credit your account. They create money and put it in your deposit account. Okay. So every loan creates money in the system. So that's the first way in which money is put in. Okay. The second way is government spending. When government spends through a fiscal deficit, when it is spending money it does not have, and it is borrowing from the banking system like it is right now, then that creates money as well. When the government spends that money, it comes into our account, it creates money. Okay. The third route is FX inflows, which is where the FX angle comes in. When you have FX inflows, either through FPI in equity or FPI in debt or ECBs or FDI, when money comes in, that gets credited to somebody's account and therefore money is created. From foreign currency converts into local currency and money is created. Okay. So these are the three routes in which money is created. Now, here are some rough numbers. I don't remember the exact numbers. I'll give you the rough numbers. M3 has grown quite dramatically, like I mentioned. M3 has grown by about 12.5% year on year. M1 has grown by about 20% year on year. And here are the components of the growth. The amount of money that RBI and banks have lent to the government for the fiscal deficit, that has added about 8.5 lakh crores of money in the system. Okay. So 8.5 lakh crores purely from fiscal spending, from banks giving money to the government. Okay. About 7.75, or let's call it 8 lakh crores. Another 8 lakh crores is actually FX inflows, because we've seen a large current account surplus. We've seen large FDI. We've seen large FPI into equity. All that has added another 8 lakh crores in the last fiscal year, in the current fiscal year. Okay. Credit has only added about 3 lakh crores in the system. So a bulk of the money is being added because of government spending and by FX inflows, not by credit offtake. Okay. Why is this important? Because monetary policy responses, removal of banking liquidity or increasing repo rates is most useful when the money is being created because of credit growth. Okay. Think of it this way. What happens when interest rates go up? When interest rates go up, then you and I, if you're looking to borrow, our borrowing costs go up. Therefore, we borrow less. Okay. So if you're borrowing a lot, if all of us are sitting and borrowing money and buying houses and doing leverage transactions and buying consumer goods or whatever it is, at that point of time, hiking interest rates reduces the amount of credit growth and therefore reduces the amount of money being created. That's monetary theory. Okay. In the current context, our credit growth is barely 6% year on year. It's the lowest we have seen in the last, I don't know how many years. Okay. And it's been like this for a long, long time. So at this point of time, hiking interest rates or removing banking liquidity, there is nothing to kill in credit growth. In fact, you would argue that credit growth is too low. It should be a little higher for the good of our economy. Okay. So you're not helping on the credit side at all. On the contrary, in fact, let's talk about government spending. Does government spending really depend upon interest rates? Do you think the government is bothered at what rate it's borrowing money? Irrespective of where interest rates are, it's going to spend, right? So again, interest rates do not change fiscal deficit or money creation by the government. On the last bit on FX inflows, if you push up interest rates a lot, you actually get in more FX inflows. If you push up your short-term rates to 5%, for instance, what will happen is people will bring in money from outside because your interest rates are very, very rich. That's called the carry trade, because you get much higher interest rates in India compared to the US, and you don't expect the rupee to depreciate. So you actually see then carry trades coming in. So in a funny way, in the current context, hiking rates or removing banking liquidity can actually end up creating more money rather than reducing the amount of money. Now, this is the theory. Unfortunately, nobody will have this debate in the country. RBI is very programmed right now that if inflation comes in, you have to remove banking liquidity. You have to try and tighten interest rates. Okay. Now, will RBI actually do that? It's a great question. If you look at the language coming in from RBI, they are walking a tightrope. Clearly, the Monetary Policy Department of RBI is worried about inflation. If you see the minutes and if you see Dr. Patra's statement, if you see Mridul Sagar's statement, they're very, very worried about inflation. At the same time, Governor Das is very clear. He wants to try and keep the borrowing cost low. Of course, he seems to be fighting a slightly losing battle in the last few days. But nevertheless, he's done OMOs. He's actually scolded the markets for taking rates higher, all of that. So they're trying to walk this tightrope. But if inflation goes up, Remember, RBI is an inflation targeting central bank. They cannot ignore it. They will eventually have to shift towards trying to do something, or at least be seen as doing something to handle inflation. So that's the second part about inflation and liquidity and monetary policy. I'm sure you guys understand the difference between liquidity and money supply, by the way. We keep targeting liquidity as if it's money supply. It's not. Liquidity is banking assets which are idle with the RBI. Banking money supply is what is the real possible cause of inflation, which is, you know, money with you and me sitting in, which we can use for consumption, etc. But liquidity does have a point. If you tighten liquidity, banks don't lend as much. So the credit growth comes down, and therefore money creation through credit growth comes down if you squeeze off liquidity. Okay. Now the last part, how does all this impact FX markets? In the last year, in this current fiscal year, we've seen a lot of money coming in from various sources from globally, right? We had a current account surplus. Current account surplus, why? Because our imports collapsed, okay? Second, we had large FDI. Reliance itself brought in so much of FDI into the country. Third, over the last 4-5 months, we've had tremendous, about $35 billion worth of net FDI coming in, sorry, net FPI into equities coming in over the last, you know, since October, November or so. So plenty of money coming in. And that creates banking liquidity. Now, at a time when inflation is going up, remember, RBI's programmed response if inflation is going up is try and control liquidity, try and increase short-term rates. Whether it works or not, we discussed earlier, ignore that. RBI's programmed response is that. Okay. Now, when FX inflows come in, they create more and more banking liquidity. So what does RBI do? RBI does not like this banking liquidity at this point in time. It starts buying in the forward markets, right? It buys dollars in the forward rather than the spot. If it was to buy in the spot market, it would increase the liquidity. If it buys in the forward market, kab tab ka dab dekhenge, abhi kuch nahi karna hai. Now, here is the first question that should be asked. Why can't RBI suck out liquidity using money market instruments like MSS, etc.? And by the way, it's a great question. Do you know that the rupee rate implied in the FX market, which is 1 year MIFOR, and many of you would know it, you are market participants, is something that's in fact come down over the last few days. It was 5.7%. It's now come down to about 5.4% or so. Okay. So the rupee rate implied in the FX market is already very, very high. In fact, RBI is borrowing money effectively at that very, very high rate when it's doing a forward purchase of dollars. Why is it doing that when its MSS will go at 3.5% or so? Because MSS is a political animal, right? MSS, when you do an MSS, the government has to issue bonds which it cannot use the money for. The whole point of MSS is just suck out the liquidity and keep it tight, okay? So there is an obvious cost to the government at a time when the fiscal deficit is so tight, okay? So the government hates MSS. And RBI has a very tough time trying to explain to the government ki boss MSS karo. It becomes a political animal. Usse achha hai, forward karo. Koi dikhta nahi hai. No person in the market actually tracks forward markets except people like you and me. So fark nahi padta hai. Let's just do it there and tab ka tab dekhenge. Okay. And because of that, until December, the data shows about $47 billion worth of forward buying by the RBI. Tremendous amount of forward buying by the RBI. Okay. What does that mean for the FX? That's one of the reasons why your forward premium went so high, right? Your 1 year premium went to about 3.85 rupees. Now it's come down to about whatever, 3.55 rupees or so, but it did shoot up quite substantially over the last few months. Okay. What happens when forward premium goes that high because of RBI buying in the forward market? Remember, all the inflows are coming in the spot market. You have current account surplus, which is spot market. You have FDI, which is spot market. You have FPI in equity, which is spot market. RBI is buying in the forward market, right? So with all these mismatches coming through, one thing is that banks are sitting on tons of dollars. In the actual balance sheet, they're sitting with lots of dollars, which they have to place overseas. Okay, so that's one implication of that. Second thing is your forward premium has gone up quite sharply because of all this RBI buying. When your forward premium is this high, what happens? Exporters love to sell, importers hate to buy. People who have taken ECBs hate to hedge because the premium cost is extremely high. In fact, the premium cost for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years is even worse. It really goes up quite sharply. And NDF market folks who are looking at this NDF points, and by the way, NDF and onshore are now very, very close to each other because of all the pipes that we have since the changes in the market. So NDF participants love to sell, okay? So what you see is you see net exporter hedging, you see ECBs not being hedged, You see NRIs bringing in money in through the forward market, NDF market, and speculators selling in the forward market, especially in the NDF market. Okay. Do we have a sense of how much is this speculative position built up? Actually, we can guess. Okay. So if you look up to December, the RBI has bought, I'm sensing by up till January, the RBI has bought about $130 billion as of January. Okay. We don't know the exact numbers. In fact, we are waiting for the RBI bulletins to come out to confirm these numbers. But rough and tough, about $130 billion in this fiscal year, RBI has bought. What is the permanent flow which is coming? If you add current account surplus, if you add FDI, and if you add FPI, you get about $105 billion until January. So 105 is this permanent flows coming in, but RBI has bought 130. Where is this difference of $25 billion coming from? What dollars has RBI bought? This $25 billion seems like a carry trade. Net exporter selling, ECB is not being hedged, and NDF people taking on positions in rupee because the carry is so high. Okay. Now, what has happened in the last month? I gave you numbers up to January. What happened in the last 1 month? Over the last few days, you would have seen this LEF relief that the RBI has given. What has RBI done? RBI has allowed local banks to at least buy some amount of US treasuries up to a certain limit from the global markets. It's a complicated issue, and I can take it up as a Q&A if you want. But in a sense, that's the reason why forward premium has come down. Okay, because now banks are not desperate to do sell buy in the short term markets to get rid of their dollars. I can expand on this if you're interested. It's a rabbit's hole for people who are there in the market. I can expand on this if required. That's point number one. Second, a lot of the carry trade folks have also started to go out. In fact, when you saw the action yesterday was a brutal day, right? Dollar rupee went up by more than a rupee. What really happened? My sense is the following. One, of course, you had some FPI outflows, maybe out of about $1 billion, $1.1 billion of FPI outflows. I'm also sensing that some of this FX carry trades which have built up, particularly from overseas, which is maybe $20, $25 billion until January, some of it went out. And that's the problem with these carry trades. These carry trades they can reverse, and they do reverse periodically. Okay, so it looks like those carry trades have reversed as well. So the long story is the following. Because RBI has an inflation problem, which frankly it can't control, and it's more about jobs and output rather than monetary policy. But RBI has to be seen as doing something. So it tries to control liquidity and short-term rates. That FX inflows creates problems in liquidity management. So they start doing forward purchases. That forward purchases pushes up forward premium. That brings in more carry trades. And that carry trades makes FX markets extremely volatile. And at the moment, since until October, I couldn't see any carry trades at all in the market. From November to January, I could sense about $25 billion of carry trades being put on, which is long rupee, short dollars. Okay, and some of it looks like got out yesterday because they were feeling nervous about what's happening globally, US Treasury yields going up and all of that. So some reversal has happened. So that's the broad connect between all of this. Very quick prognosis on what's going to happen. I genuinely worry about inflation. And all of it boils down to, do we create enough domestic output? It's not in RBI's hands. Inflation is not in RBI's hands. It is in, do we create enough output to match whatever demand we create internally? Okay. How do we measure output? How do we check whether it's happening or not? I'm going to track things like core inflation, headline inflation, IIP to see how much is domestic production going up. Job creation. Now, unfortunately, we don't have good jobs data in the country, but whatever jobs data is there, you have to track that very closely. Imports. If you see imports going up quite substantially, it's again telling you we are seeing a repeat of some smaller repeat of 2009, 2013, where demand is going up and it's being met by imports rather than by domestic production. These things have to be watched. The good news, a comparison with 2009, 2013 is not fair. At that time, we had a lot of policy paralysis and a lot of the investments that were made just went foot. Now there is a lot of focus on domestic production. So hopefully we create domestic jobs and output. We have time. We don't have to create it tomorrow. We've got $583 billion of reserve. So we have time for the next few years or so. So hopefully in the next 2-3 years, we create jobs and output, and that therefore eases all the problems that we have. Okay. So that's the first point. I am really worried about inflation. if domestic output does not keep pace, and we have government spending and we have consumption coming up, why? How do we know consumption is coming up? Look at GST numbers. GST numbers going up is a sign of consumption coming up. And this is even before contact services resumes. We've still not seeing tourism resume. We've still not seeing other, you know, entertainment, etc. resume. That will eventually hopefully come up as well once the vaccination is done. So you will see, therefore, pressure on inflation continue. And the worst nightmare for a banker, for a central banker, is if you get the combination of high inflation, uneven growth, high imports, high fiscal deficit, and something like a taper tantrum. There is nothing RBI can do. You know, you can curse them as much as you want, but frankly, there's nothing they can do if all this combination comes together. And I'm sure that's the nightmare that RBI is worried about right now. Okay. And that remains my fear as well. The solution, jobs and output. If we get jobs and output, none of these issues will come up. FX markets mein kya hoga? I think RBI is building up reserves consistently for more than a year now, purely as a insurance hedge against all of this. Okay. They are worried about a 2009-2013 repeat in some form or shape, even though it's not comparable at all. For them, and I think it's very sensible, having a large amount of FX reserves is tremendous insurance buffer against something like that happening again. Second, they also look at RER very closely, real effective exchange rate. That still shows rupees very, very overvalued. At a time when you want to do Atmanirbhar Bharat, you want to increase domestic output, a stronger rupee is terrible news for the country. What does it do? It's not that we'll export less. It's that we will import more. It's cheaper to import from outside most goods in my room, at least, than making it in India. If you have currency also strengthen and terms of trade shift against you, it will make it only worse. So I think RBI is clearly trying to hold the bottom on dollar rupee, building up a lot of reserves as an insurance buffer. At some stage, if you see inflation, I do worry that FX rupee can weaken over a period of time. The problem is today the forward premium is so high. Even after the premium came down over the last 2-3 days, it's still very, very high. Okay, the implied rates are still very, very high. To that extent, will it cross the implied forwards? Very difficult to tell at this point in time. I'm guessing though that if RBI eases up further, forward premium might come down a little more, and you might see therefore pressure on rupee continuing. FX inflows will probably continue for a while. Normally, the Jan to March quarter is pretty good. So you will see FX inflows continue for a while. But medium to long term, I do worry that current account is going to turn the other way, especially if we are not producing enough of our own. And to that extent, therefore, I do worry about the health of rupee on a medium to long term basis. I'll stop here and I'll happy to take questions if any, please. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time and thanks for your patience. And once again, thanks to Philip Capital for the last minute change in the itinerary. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much, sir. So I would request all the participants, if they have any questions, they can write in the chat box of Philip Capital India so that we can, you know, take it up.
Hello, sir. This is Murtaza here. Sir, can I ask you a question, sir? Am I audible, Vishakha?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Please go ahead, Murtaza. Sorry, I was on mute. Apologies. Yeah, please go ahead, Murtaza.
So, sir, now we are approaching March 2021. March 2020 was a dreadful month for rupee. So, by any means, all the cocktails which you mentioned, maybe higher liquidity, more supply and inflation, all these things, do we see a repeat of March 2020 for rupee specifically in March 2021?
No, not really, Murtaza. The reason for that is the following. Look, never say never. We can only guess, and who knows what will happen in the market. But if you had to put a gun on my head, I'll tell you, I doubt it. The reason being that RBI has tremendous amount of reserves right now, right? $583 billion. Of course, it's come down yesterday. I'm told they sold in the market yesterday. So it would have come down now, but it still has plenty of dollars of reserves. Okay, so let's think of what could cause a big move up in dollar rupee. First, I hope and pray it doesn't happen, but something like a COVID-19 second wave. Okay, which is why please wear your masks. But I'm assuming that will not happen. And in any case, I don't think we'll go through a lockdown, et cetera. Again, we can't take it. Or there's a global disaster. So something like a taper tantrum in 2013, we saw a bit of it last week, right? We saw US Treasury yields going up and therefore things moving up. But the relative ability of the RBI to control rupee right now is extremely high. Okay. And given they've bought so much of dollars and they've got so much of flak for buying so much of dollars, I think they'll be happy to use some of it in case there is a idiosyncratic risk against India. Okay. What could still take up dollar rupee is, so let's say there is a case where dollar itself strengthens globally. So right now, everybody's been talking about dollar weakening, right? So supposing dollar itself strengthens because US Treasury yields go up even further, then the whole world, DXY itself will go up. The dollar index itself will go up. In such cases, you could see dollar rupee also move up. That will be fine with the RBI. I don't think they'll have a problem with that at all. But a shock like March 2020 repeating now, I don't think will happen yet. I think RBI has got plenty of reserves now to control that.
And sir, one more question. As you mentioned that on real terms, you are overvalued. Yeah. But I think the real composition was recently revised. That's and right. Based on that, I think there is no overvaluation. But it was recently, I was seeing some chart. It showed that we are undervalued on real terms and on near terms, both on nominal exchange rate as well.
On NER terms, Murtaza, you're absolutely right. We actually show undervalued. But NER is the wrong thing to look at. Nobody looks at nominal effective exchange rate. You have to look at real effective exchange rate. Now, you're right. RER was changed by RBI recently. I think just last month. It used to be the 2005-36 country base year, 2005 base year. I think now they've made it 40 country trade weighted 2016 or so base year. Okay. By the way, it was almost a parallel shift. So it just shifted down. For the old RER was about 118 or so. It just came down to 106 or so. So almost like a parallel shift across the curve. Okay. It still shows, now you could argue what is overvalued, but it still shows overvaluation. Okay. Here is the other thing, Murtaza. Because we are looking at real effective exchange rate, which is inflation adjusted. Okay. The moment you have higher inflation in India compared to USA, rupee will keep having to weaken every day or every month for it to maintain the same area. So the more you're stable as dollar rupee, the more you become overvalued, right? Because of our inflation differential. Now, here is the other caveat on RER, Murtaza. RER is a nonsensical indicator to look at for a day trader. Okay. Nobody trades based on RER. But it is an indicator that RBI looks at for the medium to long run. And therefore, it's something to keep in mind, given that, frankly, all markets, bond markets and FX markets are entirely in RBI's hands right now. Yeah. So if you're a trader, I pity you, because they, based on what RBI has for breakfast, they will do whatever they want in the markets. So, and you have to live with that. Right? But it is something that they track in the medium to long run. Yeah. And by the way, even from an RER perspective, including the new one, rupee does show us slightly undervalued, overvalued even now. Sorry.
Yes, Amit. Is there any metrics where how much overvaluation will indicate that this is the ripe time for rupee to weaken? I mean, I was seeing that whenever we hit 120, 125, then we see a sudden burst of weakness in rupee.
Yeah.
So have you seen in your experience in the past that when overvaluation increases to such extent, then it's a right time where we can see a massive blow on rupee as such?
Sure. So in the old series, Murtaza, which I'm more familiar with, anything above 118 used to get me worried. Okay. And typically it has lasted about 118 for a long time, and then suddenly it will come down. I don't know how it will be in the new series, because we have to track how RBI kind of responds to movements in the new series. I think the new number was showing at about 106 or so, 106, 107. So we'll have to see. But here is the problem, Murtaza. As I said, the call is RBI's. So even in the old series, I think practically for most of the time in this last 10 years, RER was above 110. Yeah. So it means throughout the last 10 years, it was overvalued by 10% plus, or at least a bulk of
Correct.
It. So frankly, it's a, you know, so in the old series, above 118, I used to get worried.
Great. So Vishakha, I think you have many more questions in your chat box. Can you just spell it out to sir?
I see a hand by Amit Sajeja. Yes.
Vishakha?
Yes, sir. So we have some questions. The chat box will take them up first.
Yes,
so
please.
First question is, do we see some taper off in the US yields?
We already saw one yesterday, no? So it's back, the 10-year yield, I believe, is down back to 1.4. I'm not an expert on US Treasury yields. I'm not an expert in India as well, but US Treasury yields even less so. The sense I get is inflation can be a problem even in the US. Now, I belong to this think tank called Observatory Group, and I have a counterpart called Mary Rosenbaum, who used to attend Fed meetings, by the way, FOMC meetings. So she's far more experienced than I am. She laughs at me when I say this, so that's a caveat. But here is one statistic. The M1 that I spoke about, okay, which is currency in circulation plus money in the checking accounts, that's grown by 50% in the US. Okay, compare that to after the global financial crisis, where M1 barely moved. So here is the difference between the monetary response or the policy response from the global financial crisis to now. After the global financial crisis, banking liquidity went up dramatically. The Federal Reserve bought a lot of assets and they gave money to the banks, and the banks were sitting on money. This time around, what has happened is money has gone directly to the hands of people like you and me. So the US has given everybody a check, right? $1,300, then $600, now another $1,300 going through eventually, right? It's money in the hands of people. It's M1. So the M1 amount has gone up by 50% in the US. Now, at the moment, you know, again, the contact-based services, etc., has not yet resumed. So to that extent, sorry, my apologies. So the contact-based services has not resumed. So to that extent, full consumption is not yet possible. But eventually, as the vaccination increases in the US, and it is increasing in the US, vaccination percentages, you will see some of that coming back. So I do think there is an inflation risk. And the reason you saw this attack on treasury yields was because there were some bond vigilantes who are taking the Fed on. The Fed will, I think, try and keep a lid on the yields. So you will not see a smooth move up on bond yields. It will be kept down. But if I was to bet, if I was to trade right now, I would rather bet that in a year's time, US Treasury yields could be about 2%. I think there's a serious risk of inflation coming back, not just in India, but across the globe. But that's my personal view. I could be wrong.
Okay, so so another question is, do you see recent up move in USD 10-year sustainable above 1.5? Do you see Fed remaining behind the curve, and will they do something about it? Raise rates earlier than expected.
Okay, so the raise rates, I don't think will happen. So again, I'll tell you the views of my colleague that I mentioned, Mary Rosenbaum, in Observatory Group. She thinks eventually a taper will happen. But she thinks that the Fed is very, very clear. It does not want to start the taper. So let it be ECB, let it be Japan, let it be anybody else, but not the Fed. Okay. Second, again, after the issues that they saw in the last 3-4 years, when they raised rates and then the whole market collapsed, they want to be slow this time. They would rather be accused of being too slow to react rather than too fast to react. Okay. So by all yardsticks, therefore, it appears that unless there is a real shocker of an inflation print. By the way, if you saw the last testimony from Chairman Powell, he was very clear. He said inflation will go up. He said there is a base effect. We are expecting inflation to show up, but we will look through it because it's a base effect, right? So even if it goes to 2-2.5% in the US, I don't think they're going to be very perturbed. What might worry them? If it suddenly goes to 4% and it stays there for a while, that's when they would start to react. So the threshold for them to react, I think, is very, very high. It's not. And plus, they've indicated now they want to look at average inflation, which means, and they've not even said how over what period of time. So I don't think the Fed is in any hurry at all to hike interest rates at this point in time. Okay, they would rather be behind the curve than in front of the curve. So the second part is on US Treasury yields itself. Will they tolerate that? Now, that's a great question. And so far, Chairman Powell has said, yields going up is actually a good sign. It's a sign that there is economic normalcy coming back, and therefore a good steep curve is always good. It's always a good sign for the economy. But they would also be worried that if the rate rise was to happen too rapidly and therefore cause a problem on other markets and cause a problem on sentiment and so on and so forth, then there is a chance they might increase QE and they might increase the duration of the QE. Okay. There is also speculation on will they do yield curve control, which is will they start targeting the 2-year point and saying that I don't want the 2-year point to go beyond this, something like that. But the threshold for that happening as well, which is giving relief to the system, is also high. It's not that the Fed will walk in tomorrow and do this. You know, so last week they said nothing about US Treasury yields going to 1.5, etc. So base case, I think the yields will go up, but it will not be a smooth rise, because if it is too sharp a rise, Fed will push it down. But eventually, I do think inflation will be on the higher side, and it's a personal view. And therefore, I think, you know, as I said, 1 year's time, it will be higher than 2%. Personal view.
Okay, so sir, our next question is, what is more detrimental for Indian market? Is US surging bond yield or high inflation? What do you feel about US interest rate going forward? Will they increase as what is indicated in the US yield curve?
So I've given my views on the yield curve, which I won't repeat over a third time. What is more detrimental? Let me put it this way. I'm going to give you a third answer. The worst situation for India is if we do not create domestic output and jobs. Okay. Now the problem I'm speaking again from my personal view as a professor. We spend so much of time talking about the right monetary policy framework and the right fiscal policy framework, right currency framework. Here is a question for you guys. Tell me, what is China's monetary policy framework? And I know some of you will know this. Tell me, what is China's fiscal policy framework? You know, the point is, China did not become China because of a fantastic monetary policy framework. It did not become China because of a fantastic fiscal policy framework. Most people, and I can tell you even economists, will not have a clue how China's monetary policy works. Okay, they became China because they created jobs and output. Okay. We absolutely slipped in 2009, 2013 because we could not create jobs and output. Okay. It will be a tragedy if between the next 3 or 4 years, we again have the same problem that we don't create enough jobs and output. Then nothing can save us. It doesn't matter what happens to global yields. It doesn't matter what happens to whatever. If we are creating demand by way of pushing in money into the system and not creating enough domestic output and jobs, we are headed for disaster. That will be our worst, worst absolute news. Thereafter, it will show up in inflation, it will show up in whatever. Yeah. But to answer your specific question, I think domestic factors matter more than global factors. Global factors will accentuate whatever is happening domestically. If we have a robust recovery in domestic output and jobs, it doesn't matter if global rates go up. Yes, we will have shocks, we will have up and down, but we'll easily manage. We'll not have a crisis or an existential crisis.
So our last question is, sir, gold being the best hedge against inflation has seen a substantial fall since the improving COVID situation. Is that an indication that investors globally are not fearing inflation, or is money flowing to new asset class BTC as a hedge to inflation?
Superb question. When you find out the answer, please let me know. But since you asked, I'll give you a hypothesis. Yes, Bitcoin and cryptocurrency is becoming an asset class. You know, we can rave and rant about it. We can say it's all complete nonsense, but a lot of people are adding cryptocurrency. A lot of people, not in India, but in US and other countries, they're adding Bitcoin as part of their asset allocation. Okay. And therefore it's being seen as a hedge the way a gold used to be seen in the past. So there is definitely a bit of that. Gold prices itself, look, it has gone up over the year. Okay, it's come down the last few days. It's come down over the last few months, but overall, it's still gone up over the last few 2-3 years. Maybe that's an indication of inflation risks. The final answer, I can tell you what I'm doing personally. It goes back to that old maxim of work on asset allocation, don't work on views too much. Okay. Ideally, what you have to decide is how much you want to hold in equities, how much in debt, how much in gold, how much in real estate, how much in foreign currency. Take a mix and just live by it. Okay. The happiest human being is somebody who did not have to change his or her asset allocation portfolio over the last 12 months. It means their portfolio is brilliant if you didn't have to change it at all. Through all the chaos that we saw of everything collapsing and then everything recovering, you've just done extremely well. In that asset allocation, will I keep gold? I will keep gold. Okay. As a hedge to inflation, do not expect hedges to work perfectly. Okay, you will have ups and downs. You will have lack of correlation some points in time. But Am I worried about inflation? I am. Do I have gold in my portfolio? I do. But is it something which is going to make me lose sleep every day? No, not absolutely not. It's a small part of my overall asset allocation. Unfortunately, I don't hold Bitcoin because I don't think India will be allowed to hold Bitcoin very soon.
So one last question, sir, we have. What happens to the huge liquidity created, almost more than 14 trillion, I guess? Where does this liquidity flow to? Will we see flood of dollars in EMs and its impact on time to come?
So if my theory is right, that inflation will come back in the global markets as well, in developed markets. And by the way, a lot of people laugh at me when I say this. They're probably right because I only look at it from an India lens. I don't know the global sense. But if inflation does come back globally, central banks will withdraw that liquidity. Okay, it will get sucked out at some stage. Two things will happen to suck out that liquidity. One is, as I said, the central banks will withdraw the liquidity. Second is, eventually governments might start to suck out the liquidity as well. Look, governments have done a lot of fiscal pumping, right? So they have spent money, they have actually credited people's accounts and so on and so forth. If they sense too much of inflation coming through, they might have to raise taxes. US is already talking about it. They might have to borrow money from people so that the money goes out of the system. Either which way, liquidity eventually will get sucked out if and when inflation comes in. And by the way, there are plenty of instruments to suck out liquidity. There's no shortage of instruments. It's only a politically, it's a very tough thing to do to suck out liquidity. Imagine Governor Das's predicament or India's predicament. You know, when we are still struggling with the recovery, etc. Anytime he takes out liquidity, we will all scream, "Oh, we're taking out liquidity." And so, you know, it's always tough to remove the punch bowl. Unfortunately, at some stage, it will have to be done.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. So I would like to extend vote of thanks to Anand, sir. And after that, we will take up questions related to BSE, which Mr. Ojas Shah will address. So thank you so much, Anand, sir. It was a very comprehensive and exhaustive discussion covering all the aspects of the subject. And I'm sure that all the participants would be taking along with them immense amount of knowledge, wisdom, and experience obtained from your discussion. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Vishakha. Really appreciate. And thank you again for the flexibility and all the best. Thanks, Ojas. Lovely listening to you as well. Yeah. Take care. Cheers.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Sir, so first question related to BSE, what are transaction charges to trade on BSE? Also, please explain how interoperability is beneficial.
Okay, so I'll take up this question. In terms of the difference in transaction charges, BSE has started the currency trading platform from late of 2013, somewhere around November 2013, and has been gaining exponential market share from there onwards. So currently, the market share of BSE currency is practically more than 40-50% on a continuous basis, with practically the lowest transaction charges in the currency market. In the currency market, what BSE charges is roughly 22 rupees per crore, compared to the other transaction charges levered by other exchange at 90 rupees per crore. You straight away save practically 70 rupees at transaction charges plus the GST difference, which you save on the currency market. So this is straight away benefit which you save in the FX market. And you know, currency being in terms of the margins are very thin in the currency market for the day traders, this transaction charges makes a lot of difference to them. So this is what we talk about the futures. When you talk about the options, it is further probably beneficial for the market participants. BSE charges just 100 rupees per crore on the premium turnover, while the other exchanges charge roughly around 3,500 rupees per crore. So that is a huge difference in terms of the transaction charges for any market participant to trade. And BSE is highly liquid, so it is probably in the benefit of the market participant to look at BSE as a preferred avenue in terms of trading on the FX market. Now, related to the other question on the interoperability, probably I'm not sure whether most of the guys are aware about the interoperability framework. So I'll just take 1 minute to briefly about what is interoperability. So in interoperability, basically, you need to, as a client or as a member broker or as an intermediary of any stock broker, what you do is you keep a common collateral across exchanges and you can trade on any of the exchanges. So prior to interoperability has been applicable from 2018 onwards, somewhere late of 2018 onwards. Prior to interoperability, what used to happen is you have to keep separate collateral for say BSC currency, NSC currency, or any other exchanges. And so the collateral allocation was very difficult. Now with the interoperability framework, you need to keep a single collateral across exchanges, and you can trade on any of the exchanges at any point of time. One more important point of the interoperability or the benefit of interoperability is you can trade or even square up your positions across exchanges. I mean, your first leg of transaction could be BSC currency, you can square up your trade at other exchange or vice versa. So this is the benefit of interoperability. Now as we come to the recent technical glitch, which is a practically the hot topic nowadays, I mean, it has happened just 2 days back. What happened is, it was expiry of the currency market, where the contracts were going to expire on that day. What happened was, most of the players who had access to the BSC currency market had seamlessly traded on the BSC currency market or spread up their positions and got a probably leverage out of that. While few of them who did not have the access to BSC currency, probably their member broker did not give them access, or they did not have the KYC done for the BSC currency, could not trade on the BSC currency market. So it is probably in the benefit of market participant to do the KYC or the paperwork with your broker member, and also request your broker member to provide the access to the currency market. Vishak, your voice is in mute, I think. Just unmute your voice.
I'm sorry. Sir, our last question is, what is transaction charge difference between BSC and other exchanges?
Okay, so I think that's a repeat question. Basically, we already have talked about the transaction charges difference in futures as well as options. Just for benefit of the market participant, BSC charges 22 rupees per crore in the futures. In options, we are charging 100 rupees, while the competition exchanges are charging 90 rupees for futures and 3,500 rupees for options. So you save a lot in terms of transaction charges with practically equivalent or higher liquidity at BSC currency.
So I think we have covered up all the questions, sir. So I would like to thank you for resolving all the queries regarding this and joining us on a weekend. And I would like to thank all the participants for joining in the webinar. I hope it was very informative. For any other queries, you may contact us. Our coordinates are there on the screen. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vishaka. Thank you, all the market participants.